The lysosome is a compartment in eukaryotic cells that destroys proteins nonspecifically. This compartment destroys viral and bacterial proteins ingested via endocytosis, as well as membrane-associated proteins. However, 80 to 90% of intracellular proteins are destroyed via the proteasome. Similar mechanisms are employed by eukaryotes and prokaryotes, but in this video, we will focus on the eukaryote side of things. In the previous video, we covered how the cell deals with misfolded proteins. In brief, molecular chaperones and the proteasome compete over these proteins to prevent their buildup. Proteins typically reach their native conformation through entropically driven hydrophobic collapse, which means that their hydrophobic amino acids are in the protein interior. However, misfolded proteins, in addition to a lack of functionality, have exposed hydrophobic regions. When they accumulate, there is nonspecific binding of these exposed hydrophobic regions, which results in aggregates. Aggregates can be dissolved by disaggregation chaperones, but that's a topic for another video. Chaperones help proteins fold correctly, causing hydrophobic collapse. In addition to preventing nonspecific binding of exposed hydrophobic regions, this also makes the protein structure more stable. However, chaperones aren't always able to help, and some proteins can never fold properly due to mistakes in transcription, RNA splicing, and translation. Therefore, proteasomes, which will be the focus of this video, are needed to destroy proteins. Proteasomes break the peptide bonds in proteins in a process termed proteolysis, leading to their breakdown into smaller polypeptides, 90% of which range between 2 to 10 amino acids in length. Cells can distinguish normal and abnormal proteins and degrade ones that are damaged or unneeded. This ability is highly regulated, as dysfunction can cause disease. An aberrant protein undergoes several steps in order to be degraded by the proteasome. To summarize and oversimplify the process, first, the protein is modified through a process called ubiquitination, which tags it for destruction. It is then unfolded and chopped up into short polypeptides by the proteasome. Once the proteasome releases these short polypeptides, they get further broken down into their amino acid building blocks by other proteases. Let's look at how ubiquitination works. A small protein called ubiquitin, which cells maintain at high concentrations, serves as a tag. Depending on the modification pattern of the ubiquitin, there can be different meanings. In this case, the tag is saying, "Kill me!" The overall system of ubiquitination and proteasomal degradation is called the ubiquitin-proteasome system, and it carries out the ubiquitin-dependent degradation of proteins. Let's take a closer look at ubiquitin. The C-terminus, a glycine tail, is the position at which the ubiquitin gets attached to its target protein. This linkage between the carboxyl group of the glycine residue and the epsilon amino group of a lysine residue on the substrate is a type of amide bond called an isopeptide bond. The attachment of ubiquitin to either a substrate protein or to another ubiquitin is termed the conjugation of ubiquitin. You can even have ubiquitination on several lysine residues on a protein simultaneously. However, this is not necessary for the proteasome to then target the protein. The ubiquitin is attached to proteins via the ubiquitination system, which involves three enzymes, E1, E2, and E3. Ubiquitin activating enzyme, otherwise called E1, is ATP-dependent. E1 activates ubiquitin at the C-terminus through adenylation and transfers it to one of a set of ubiquitin conjugating enzymes, otherwise called E2 enzymes, through transthiolation. E2s partner with accessory E3 proteins, and together the E2-E3 complex is called ubiquitin ligase. E3 works by binding to degrons in the protein substrate, which are portions of proteins that allow for regulation of protein degradation via specific degradation signals. The bond formed when E3 ligates the C-terminal carboxyl group of the ubiquitin to a lysine residue on the substrate protein is an isopeptide bond. As the ubiquitins are added, they produce a linear series of ubiquitin-ubiquitin conjugates. The polyubiquitin can be recognized by the proteasome. Interestingly, in humans, we know of only two E1s. However, there are around 30 E2 enzymes and hundreds of different E3s that complex only with specific E2s. The resulting variety of ubiquitin ligases recognize and target different degradation signals which are displayed by different proteins. Now that we see how ubiquitin is attached to proteins, let's discuss the proteasome. The proteasome is a compartmentalized protease whose active sites are sequestered, or inaccessible without admission into its proteolytic chamber. The proteasome consists of three compartments which give the proteasome two external cavities and the proteolytic chamber. The two external compartments are the 19S caps on either side, and the proteolytic chamber is inside the 20S cylinder. The 19S is called the regulatory particle, since it recognizes polyubiquitinated proteins, providing selectivity for substrate degradation, and can dock at one or both ends of the 20S. When 19S is absent, the 20S has a structure in which its channel is closed. The 19S causes conformational changes in the 20S that cause gate opening. The 19S consists of 17 core subunits and can be divided into a lid and a base. The lid of the 19S is composed of 8 subunits. These include a ubiquitin receptor, which holds the ubiquitolated protein in place, as well as a ubiquitin hydrolase, which cleaves ubiquitin from the substrate protein. The base is composed of 9 subunits, including 6 AAA proteins, which belong to a class of protein unfoldases. AAA proteins, short for ATP-ases associated with diverse cellular activities, belong to the superfamily of AAA plus proteins, which act on many kinds of macromolecules, not just proteins, but also nucleic acids. For instance, they serve as helicases, unraveling DNA during DNA replication. In the proteasome, ATPases of the AAA plus family can sense aberrant proteins via their N-domains and can unfold them via hydrolysis in their ATPase domains. Thus, the AAA proteins in the proteasome form a hexameric protein unfoldase. Binding of a protein bearing a ubiquitin chain increases the rate of ATP hydrolysis of the 26S complex by 2 to 3 times. The amount of ATP consumed in degrading these ubiquitin-bound proteins is surprisingly large, and is affected by how large and tightly folded the protein is. The rate of ATP hydrolysis of the proteasome is proportional to its rate of hydrolysis of ubiquitolated proteins. One misconception about proteasomes is that they are very particular about what kind of ubiquitin chains they bind and disassemble. However, they are not picky about the type or length of the ubiquitin chains on substrates. It has been shown that the proteasome is technically capable of degrading proteins with short ubiquitin chains, even ones with only a single ubiquitin. However, the proteasome has different affinities for different ubiquitin chain lengths and its likelihood of degrading them once they are bound. The longer the chain, the greater its affinity for the proteasome. A single ubiquitin on a substrate is super unlikely to bind to a proteasome, and it is also super likely to be removed before the protein can be committed to degradation, so in practicality, it doesn't contribute to proteolysis. As it is translocated through the ATPase's central channel, the substrate protein is unfolded because the protein's upstream folding domains get linearized. And now the unfolded protein enters the 20S compartment. The 20S proteasome consists of 28 subunits. In eukaryotes, these 28 subunits consist of 2 copies of 7 different alpha subunits and 2 copies of 7 different beta subunits. The alpha subunits comprise the external rings, while the beta subunits comprise the internal rings. The 4 stacked heptameric rings have their active sites facing the inside of the proteasome. Beta subunits have 3 types of active sites, which each have different specificity, though they all employ an N-terminal threonine. The hydroxyl group of this threonine residue is converted into a nucleophile that attacks the carbonyl groups of peptide bonds, forming acyl enzyme intermediates. It used to be thought that a polyubiquitin chain tag spelled certain doom for a protein. However, in order to efficiently degrade a protein, proteasomes also need to identify a loosely folded region in the protein. This loosely folded region should be at least 30 varied residues long, fairly inflexible, and biased towards hydrophobic residues. Most proteins have such exposed regions at some point, since they can have fluctuations in their structure which cause movement resembling breathing, which is why it's called protein breathing. However, the frequency with which these regions are exposed is dramatically increased when a protein is misfolded. On the other hand, it is decreased when proteins form multimeric complexes, as loosely folded or structureless domains tend to be eliminated. Note that protein half-lives are largely determined by both presence of sequences recognizable by ubiquitin ligases and differences in folding that proteasomes can identify. It is based on both ubiquitin chains and these loosely folded regions that the proteasome decides which proteins to destroy and which to spare. There are two steps in the binding of a ubiquitinated protein to the proteasome. Initially, the ubiquitin chain attached to the protein in question binds reversibly to the proteasome. Then, there is a tighter binding ubiquitin-independent step, which requires ATP hydrolysis and depends on recognition of a loosely folded region by the proteasome. The length of time that the proteasome has to detect this loosely folded region depends on competing processes, such as the proteasome's multiple deubiquitination enzymes, which can result in the release of the ubiquitolated protein. For example, the longer the ubiquitin chain, the more time the proteasome has before deubiquitolation results in substrate escape. Throughout the substrate recruitment process, the proteasome is thought to have three distinct conformational states: recruitment, commitment, and processing. However, once the tighter binding to the substrate's loosely folded domain is achieved, the six ATP-ases of the proteasome are activated, committing the protein to further deubiquitination, unfolding, processive translocation, and proteolysis. The processivity of the proteasome is critical to its function. Processivity is the ability of an enzyme to catalyze the same reaction over and over without releasing its substrate. Imagine the havoc that could be wreaked if proteasomes let go of only partially digested proteins. That would definitely only contribute to more aggregates. The high processivity of the proteasome distinguishes it from other proteases, which do one snip and then dissociate. The fact that ATP is needed for intracellular proteolysis, which is thermodynamically favorable, begs the question, why? Why do cells devote precious energy to this process? It is because ATP consumption makes the degradation process highly selective, enabling the substrate to unfold and enter an isolated chamber where it can be efficiently and processively hydrolyzed. Note that cells can modulate proteasome activity in various ways. For example, phosphorylation of the 20S by protein kinase A enhances its caspase activities. Meanwhile, cleavage by caspases can suppress protein degradation and result in accumulation of ubiquitinated proteins. This can occur in cells undergoing apoptosis. If you enjoyed this video, like and subscribe. You can also support me by following the link to my Patreon. If you have any topics you'd like me to cover, please leave a comment.